Hello everyone, in this video we will discuss the activity of chapter 3rd class strength, metals and non-metals. We have already covered the chapter 1 and 2 in the separate video where we have discussed all the activities. So we will perform also these activities and just discuss the conclusion and main point of these activities. इस वीडियो में हम इस चैप्टर की सभी एक्टिविटीज डिस्कस करेंगे, क्या उसका कंक्लूजन है एंड द इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट इज दिस ईयर इन CBSE एग्जाम दिस चैप्टर हैविंग द मैक्सिमम वेटेज ऑफ 9 मार्क्स. तो मैक्सिमम क्वेश्चंस एक्टिविटी वाइज फ्रेम हो सकते हैं, तो वो सभी डिस्कस करेंगे कि क्या क्वेश्चंस इसमें से बनेंगे या किस टाइप के क्वेश्चंस MCQ, रीजनिंग एसर्शन पूछे जा सकते हैं. सो द फर्स्ट एक्टिविटी इज टेक अ सैंपल ऑफ आयरन, कॉपर, एल्यूमिनियम, मैग्नीशियम एंड नोट द अपीयरेंस ऑफ ईच सैंपल. सो आई हैव टेकन हेयर द मैग्नीशियम रिबन हेयर एंड आई विल रब इट विद सैंड पेपर. Now you can observe the layer is appear to be shiny in nature. When I am rubbing this with sandpaper, you can observe that its surface becomes shiny or lustrous in nature. So now just rubbing this. So after performing this activity, you can say iron, copper or aluminium or magnesium, after rubbing it with sandpaper, its appearance becomes shining and lustrous. So what we conclude from this activity, that metal in pure state have a shining surface and this property is called as a metallic luster. Now next activity is activity 3.2, where we have to take a small piece of iron, copper, aluminium and magnesium and we have to just cut them with the help of a knife. Now so if we try to cut these metal with the help of a knife, it becomes difficult because they are very hard. So the one conclusion which we obtained from this part, that all metals are very hard. But yes, there is an exception. For example, this is a sodium metal. I am just pressing it with filter paper. So now this is a sodium metal which can be easily cut by knife. For example, you can observe here. I am cutting it and it is easily divided into two halves here. Again, so sodium metal is the metal which is very soft in nature. It can easily cut by knife. So these are the activity related question, that is hold a piece of sodium metal with a pair of tongs, put it on watch glass, try to cut it with a knife, what do you observe? So as we have done this activity, we are able to easily cut it. That is, sodium metal is soft in nature and it is easily cut by knife. From this activity we can conclude that metals are generally hard, but hardness varies from metal to metal. For example, exceptional case, sodium metal is soft in nature and it can be easily cut by knife. Now the next activity 3.3 and 3.4, where we have to take a metal sample and just we have to hit it with hammer and then we have to observe it, and we have to repeat this activities with number of samples here. Here a metal sample here and just hitting it, and you can observe the shape of this spatula here. You can observe here it is flattened here, so with hammer we can easily change the shape, or we can say metal can be easily changed into shape by hitting it with hammer. So what we have observed, that the shape of that metal block is changes when we hit it with hammer. Now you can observe, these are the metal plates of a copper and the zinc. So this is the property which is known as a malleability, and it is defined as a property in which metal can be beaten into a thin sheet. So what is a malleability? The ability of metal that can be beaten into thin sheet is called to be malleable in nature. And the question from this topic, which two metals are most malleable metals? So answer is gold and silver. Now the next activity, consider some metals such as iron, copper, aluminium, lead, etc. Which of above metals are also available in form of wires? So all of you have observed the copper wire, the aluminium wire or the iron wire. So all these can be easily, these metals can be easily changed into a thin wires. So this property, that is ability of metal to be drawn into thin wires, is called as a ductility.
Similarly, malleability is ability of metal to be beaten into thin sheets is called malleability. And same, metal has a property that it can be easily drawn into a thin wires, and this property is called as a ductility. And one important fact that a wire of about 2 kilometer length can be drawn from 1 gram of gold. You can observe the gold jewelry where from only 1 gram of gold you can draw a wire of 2 kilometer length. Now the next activity is activity 3.5, where we have to take an aluminium or copper wire and clamp this wire on a stand and just fix a pin here with a wax and then heat this with a burner. Now you can observe when we are heating this, then after some time this pin will fall down. So here we have taken the same type of arrangement here on this spatula. I have attached 2 pins with a wax. And I will heat one end of this with a burner. And you can observe that after some time, it will fall down. Now heating will take time, so I have increased the speed of the video. So after heating for almost 5 to 6 minutes, then finally this spatula become hot and then wax is melt down and pin will fall off. Similarly, this second pin will also fall off after a few minutes. You can observe the wax is melting here and finally this pin will fall off. So this activity will confirm that metal is a good conductor of heat. That is why it conducts the heat. And it is used for making cooking utensils.
This is activity number 3.8. For this we required magnesium ribbon, a sulfur powder, a water, blue and red litmus, a china dish, a pair of tongs, spatula, and a holder fitted with a test tube. In this activity, we will burn these both samples and will collect their ash in separate test tube and then dissolve that ash and then we will add in them the blue litmus or red litmus and observe the change. So let's perform this activity. So the first part of this activity, I have taken the magnesium ribbon here and I will heat it over the Bunsen flame and then I will collect the ash of this magnesium ribbon. So magnesium react with oxygen and form magnesium oxide. It is a white dazzling flame here. So you can observe here, the white color ash is formed here. So this is the ash here, you can observe a white color ash is formed in this case. Now I will dissolve this ash in water and observe its change with red litmus. So first of all I will add a water into it and then just dissolve this here. You can observe here. Now to this I will add a red litmus into it and you can observe the change in color. So it is red in initially, it is red in color. But when it is completely react with it, it turns blue. You can observe here. So now it turns blue in color. So what we will perform the second part of the activity, where we have to take this sulfur powder and we have to heat it over the flame. And then we have to collect these fumes in an inverted test tube. So I have taken here this test tube just like this. Now I'm heating this sulfur over the flame. And then you can observe fumes are obtained which I am collecting in this test tube. You can observe here. You can observe in the test tube fumes are collected in it. Now fumes are collected in it. You can observe here fumes. Now fumes are collected in it. Now I will add water into it, water into this test tube, and will dissolve these fumes. And to this we will add a blue litmus and then you can observe the change here.
Now this blue litmus turn red in color. So I'm adding here the blue litmus, which is turn red here. So what is the difference in both case? In case of sulfur, we form an oxide, sulfur oxide, when it dissolves in water, it is acidic in nature. Whereas in case of magnesium metal here, in case of magnesium metal, when we have heated it, it forms an oxide which is basic in nature because it turns red litmus blue.
Now the question based on this activity 3.8, that is the product formed on burning of magnesium is acidic or basic? Magnesium on burning form magnesium oxide, which is white in color, and when it is dissolved in water, it forms magnesium hydroxide. And if we add red litmus to it, it turn it blue, hence it is basic in nature. So the product which is formed on burning of magnesium is basic in nature as it turn red litmus blue. Now the second part of the activity, when we burn a sulfur powder and collect its fumes and dissolve that fumes, and then we are adding blue litmus into it, then what happened? So sulfur on burning forms sulfur dioxide, which when dissolved in water forms sulfurous acid, that is H2SO3, which turns blue litmus red, hence it is acidic in nature. Now next part of activity, can you write the equation for these reaction? Magnesium react with oxygen forming magnesium oxide, which further dissolve in water forming hydroxide. Sulfur react with oxygen forming sulfur dioxide, dissolve in water form sulfurous acid, that is H2SO3. 1 mark question, most non-metal produce the acidic oxide when dissolve in water. On the other hand, metal give rise to basic oxide.
Now next activity is activity 3.9, where we have to take a sample and with the help of a tongs we have to heat it over the flame, and then again we have to collect the samples product which is formed, and we have to observe what is the flame coloration here, what is the metal surface after burning, and then we have to arrange them in their decreasing order, and we have to observe which product is soluble in water. So the first part of the activity, the question from it, what happened when metal reacts with oxygen? So metal react with oxygen forming metal oxide. The simplest example which we have performed, magnesium reacts with oxygen and it is forming magnesium oxide. We are balanced it, just writing like this. Now what is the nature of oxide? In the activity 3.8, we have already proved that metal oxides are basic in nature. Now one of the important question from this part is, define an amphoteric oxide, give 2 examples. Now this question itself is of 3 marks here. So metal oxides which can react with both acid as well as bases to produce salt and water are called as an amphoteric oxide. For example, zinc oxide and aluminium oxide. And one of the example here is Al2O3 can react with HCl forming AlCl3 and water. And Al2O3 react with base forming NaAlO2, that is sodium aluminate and water here. Now as we have observed in the last activity, that when we dissolve metal oxide in water, it forms metal hydroxide. Now the next question here is, are the metal hydroxide soluble in water? So most of the metal oxides are insoluble in water, but some of the metal oxides are soluble in water, and those metal oxides which are soluble in water are called as an alkali. For example, the sodium and potassium oxide form sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide, which is soluble in water. So in this way you have to represent the equation, sodium oxide dissolve in water forming sodium hydroxide. It is a soluble base, hence it is known as an alkali. Similarly, potassium oxide dissolves in water forming potassium hydroxide, and this alkali is, this base is soluble in water, hence it is called as an alkali. So give example, sodium hydroxide and NaOH are 2 examples, are 2 alkali, or we can say 2 bases which are soluble in water. So we can say here that all alkali are bases, but all bases are not alkali, because all bases are not water soluble, but all alkali are bases because they can release OH- ion.
So this can be framed
as 3.10, where we take a metal and we directly react it with water. What happens when metal react with water? So this, we take a piece of sodium metal here and we'll just place it in water and observe the changes. And now if we add a red litmus into it, then it turns solution blue in color. You can observe here. Now solution turn blue in color here. So which suggests that the metal reacts with water and form a metal hydroxide, which turn red litmus blue in color. You can observe here. It turn red litmus blue here. Now in activity 3.10, we have just put the small piece of metal in a beaker, or we can say in a china dish half filled with the cold water, and we have observed that sodium and potassium react vigorously with cold water and the hydrogen released is catches fire, whereas magnesium is the metal which does not react with the cold water. Now the next question, did any metal produce fire on water? So yes, sodium react vigorously and it catches fire. Does any metal start floating after some time? So when the calcium metal is react with hot cold water, it starts floating over the water. So when calcium metal reacts with the cold water, so calcium is a metal which reacts with the cold water, and the hydrogen gas which is released is attached to the surface of this calcium, due to which it starts floating. So for this we have to write answer that calcium is the metal which reacts with cold water and the hydrogen gas which is released is attached to the surface of the metal, due to which it starts floating. Now put the metal that did not react with the cold water in a beaker half filled with hot water. Which metal reacts with the hot water? So what happens if you add magnesium in cold water? Then nothing will happen. You can observe here. There is no change in it, whereas in case of sodium, when we have added it in, it is highly reactive and vigorously reactive. Add this magnesium ribbon over this hot water. I have already added one of the ribbon initially. So again I am adding this ribbon into the hot water, and now you can observe that there will be a formation of bubbles on the surface of magnesium ribbon. Magnesium does not react with the cold water, but when we add that metal into the hot water, it produces the hydrogen gas. So for this we have to write that magnesium is the metal that does not react with the cold water, but when it is added into a hot water, it releases hydrogen gas, due to which it also starts floating. Now next question, which metal did not even react with the steam? So the gold, silver, lead. So answer here is gold, silver, lead and copper. This can be framed in MCQ option, that is which metal does not react even with steam. Now one more question can be framed, which react with the steam? So iron, aluminium and zinc are the metals which can be easily react with steam. Now next, one more important point, what happened when we add a metal in a water? So what happened when metal react with the water? It form a metal hydroxide which further form metal hydroxide and it releases hydrogen gas. So this is the general statement for this activity. So if we generalize the statement, water with cold water, sodium react, potassium react and the calcium react. With hot water, which metal react? Magnesium. Which react with steam? That is aluminium, zinc and iron. And which does not react with steam is the copper, silver, gold and lead. So these are the conclusion from the activity 3.10.
अगर नेक्स्ट एक्टिविटी इज एक्टिविटी 3.11 विच इज द रिएक्शन ऑफ मेटल विद एसिड. नाउ द सैम्पल विच वी हैव नॉट टू टेक इज सोडियम और पोटेशियम. सो आई एम टेकिंग हेयर द जिंक मेटल हेयर एंड वी विल ऑब्जर्व द रिएक्शन ऑफ दिस मेटल विद HCl एज वेल एज विद HNO3. And we will observe that if we suspend thermometer into it, then the temperature increase or there is any change in temperature. So in one of the conical, we will take the HNO3 here, dilute HNO3. And in the second conical, I will take dilute HCl here. And then I will add a zinc metal into it. And you can observe the reaction here. Similarly, if I'm adding this here, then you can observe the reaction. Now, in both the cases, the gas is evolved and you can observe the difference here. Bubbles are also forming here, bubbles are also forming here. But in HNO3, the solution, the vapors forms are slightly brown in color because here, instead of hydrogen gas, nitrogen oxide is evolved. I will place a thermometer inside it. Initially temperature here is near about 12 or 13 degrees Celsius. So if I am placing it in it, then there will be a rise in temperature because it is a highly exothermic reaction. So temperature is rising here. It is exactly at nearby 30 here. Now the first question from this activity: what happened when metal react with an acid? So metal react with an acid, it form a salt here, that is MCl2, and hydrogen gas is evolved here. Now the next question from this activity is you have to write the equation of these metal on reaction with HCl. So you can observe in all the cases the salt is formed. In case of Mg, MgCl2, Al, AlCl3, Zn, ZnCl2 and Fe, FeCl3. And in each case hydrogen gas is evolved. Now one of the exception here is with HNO3 metal does not release hydrogen gas. Now why this happens? Because HNO3 is a strong oxidizing agent which itself reduced to nitrogen oxide and it oxidized hydrogen produced into water. So here HNO3, the hydrogen which is released is easily oxidized into water here, and the nitrogen which is present here is reduced into the nitrogen oxide, that is N2O, NO2 or NO, and it is a brown color gas which is evolved in a reaction. So it is a very exceptional case that all metals react with an acid releases hydrogen gas. But in case of a nitric acid, only two metals, that is Mn and Mg, manganese and magnesium, will produce the hydrogen gas. Rest all will form nitrogen oxides and oxidized hydrogen into water. Now the next question from this activity, that we have to arrange these metals in increasing order of their reactivity. So in increasing order, magnesium will be the most reactive and here iron will be the least reactive. So this is the order here. Iron is less reactive than zinc, zinc is less reactive than aluminium, and magnesium is the most reactive element here. Now on the basis of these metals, the question here is which metal react vigorously with dilute HCl. So answer will be magnesium react vigorously with dilute HCl forming MgCl2 and releasing a very large amount of hydrogen gas here. So in this case also the temperature will be highest. It is an exothermic reaction. It is a very exothermic reaction where heat is released. Hence temperature increase as you have observed in the thermometer. So it will takes place in case of magnesium. Now the next part, if I have to arrange these metal in decreasing order of their reactivity, then obvious magnesium is more reactive than aluminium, then zinc, and in the last, in comparison to all these, iron will be the least reactive here. Now the next activity is 3.12, where we have to take a clean copper wire and the iron nail and we have to place them in a solution of copper sulfate and iron sulfate and record the observation in 20 minutes. So this is the arrangement here. In copper sulfate, iron nail is dipped. In ferrous sulfate, copper piece is dipped here. So we will discuss what type of a questions can be framed from here. So the first question here, in which test tube you will find that reaction has occurred? Now the one test tube contained copper in the ferrous sulfate solution, and in another test tube iron in the copper sulfate solution. So what happened in the first case, there will be no reaction since copper is less reactive, so it will not able to displace the iron here. But in the second case, since iron is more reactive than copper, so the color of the solution will changes from blue to green. Changes from blue to green, and copper is deposited over the surface of nail. You can observe, abhi aap activity dekh rahe hain side mein. In that case, ek YouTube short or video hai jo already channel pe meri posted hai, jisme you can easily observe the color change. ठीक है. Now on what basis you can say that reaction has actually taken place? Now this is on based on the reactivity series. Now what is a reactivity series? Reactivity series is the arrangement of element. That is, it is arrangement of metal in order of their decreasing activity. So this is the series here. From potassium to gold. कल नई कार मांगी ऑल्टो जैन फरारी प्रॉब्लम है क्योर होगी अगर ऑडी प्लैटिना. So this is a simple trick to learn this reactivity series. So by this reactivity series we can say the metal which is lie above in the reactivity series able to displace the metal in the lower end. So the reaction which is a basis of this activity is the displacement reaction. If I will write the balanced equation here again, Fe plus CuSO4, it is forming FeSO4 plus Cu, and this is known as a single displacement reaction. So what is the type of reaction? It is a single displacement reaction where the more reactive element will displace the less reactive element from the compound and form this. Now next is activity 3.13, where we have to take a different samples of the compound. These are the ionic compound, and when we are heating it over the flame, then there is a coloration which is given to the flame, and you can observe that after heating also it is not melting, which means they have high melting and boiling point. So by this activity we will confirms that these ionic compound have high melting and boiling point. And in the second part of the activity, where we have to prepare this kind of a circuit where we are dissolving these salt in water and then just connecting the circuit and observing whether the bulb will glow or not. Now since ionic compound when dissolve in water produce ion here, so these ions, because of movement of ions, the current is flown in the circuit, in the solution. In the outer circuit it is electrons which are moving, but in this solution the ions are moving, hence the current travel from one electrode to another, due to which bulb glow. So which means that if we add a salt solution or salt and prepare a solution and then we join it in a circuit, then current is flown in the circuit, which means ionic compound are good conductor, but only in the molten state, not in a solid state. So by this activity what we infer, so the point here, did the sample impart any color to the flame? Yes, in case of barium it is green in color, you can observe, and in case of sodium chloride it is yellowish in color. And when we have tried this sample to dissolve in water, petrol and kerosene, since ionic compound is a polar compound, so it will be dissolved in water only, and in petrol and kerosene it will remain insoluble. And you can observe here the melting point. In case of NaCl it is a very high melting point, 1074 degree. In calcium chloride it is 1045. So from this activity we infer that ionic compound have very high melting point. Now all these activities are actually the proof of these properties of ionic compound, their physical nature. They are solid, as we have taken a solid salt. When I am heating the barium chloride, it is a solid salt. Why it is solid? Because they have a strong electrostatic force of attraction. Okay? And what is this electrostatic force of attraction? It is a force of attraction between the positive and the negative ion. Similarly, the melting point and boiling point is high. Why it is high? Because of strong force of attraction. Solubility, because it is a polar salt, hence it will be soluble in the polar solvent. For example, water. In case of water, there is a charge displacement here, minus and plus, NaCl, plus and minus. So polar will dissolve in polar, but it is insoluble in kerosene and petrol. Now these statement can be easily framed in a question answers form in reasoning and assertion part. It conducts electricity. It's a very important part that in solid state it do not conduct electricity, but in the molten state electricity is conducted because of movement of ions. Only in the molten state ionic compound conduct electricity, only in molten state and not in the solid state. And why in molten state in conduct electricity? Because ions are now able to move freely, move, hence it will conduct electricity. So by this I have covered almost all the activities of the chapter 3. The PDF of these एक्टिविटीज़ जो भी क्वेश्चन आंसर्स अभी हमने डिस्कस किए हैं वो आपको डिस्क्रिप्शन में पोस्ट मिल जाएगा. यू कैन डाउनलोड फ्रॉम देयर एंड सॉल्व इट बाय योर ओन. और आपको प्रैक्टिस से कंफर्म हो जाएगा कि आपको एक्टिविटीज समझ आई है कि नहीं आई है. सो काइंडली कमेंट इन द कमेंट सेक्शन कि आपको ये कैसा लगा. ठीक है, थैंक यू वेरी मच.